Good morning.
Good morning.
I want to start with a little story out of Luke to kind of get started on this Christmas month, Luke chapter 1. In the sixth month, God sent the angel Gabriel to Nazareth, the town of Galilee, to the virgin pledged to be married to a man named Joseph. In the city of David, the virgin's name was Mary. The angel went to her and said, "Greetings, you who are highly favored, the Lord is with you." Mary was greatly troubled at his words and wondered what kind of greeting this might be. But the angel said to her, "Don't be afraid, Mary, you found favor with God. You'll be with child, give birth to a son, and you are to give him the name Jesus. He'll be great and be called the Son of the Most High. The Lord God will give him the throne of his father David, and he will reign over the house of Jacob forever. His kingdom will never end." "How will this be, Mary?" asked the angel, "since I'm a virgin." The angel answered, "The Holy Spirit will come upon you. The power of the Most High will overshadow you. And so the Holy One to be born will be called the Son of God. Even Elizabeth, your daughter, was going to have a child at her old age. And she who was said to be barren is in her sixth month, for nothing is impossible with God." "I'm the Lord's servant," Mary answered. May it be to me as you have said." And then the angel left. Amen. Lord, we come to the God of the impossible today. For nothing is impossible for you. And so, God, we pray in Jesus' name. Lord, you meet us here today as we gather online. Lord, let your kingdom come. Let your will be done in our hearts and lives today, in our communities, in our nation. And God, we humble ourselves before you. None like you, King Jesus. We give you praise. In Jesus' wonderful name we pray. Amen. Amen. Why don't you stand and worship the Lord together today? Praise his name.
Yeah.
go ahead with your marriage to Mary, for the child within her has been conceived by the Holy Spirit, and she will have a son, and you are to name him Jesus, for he will save his people from their sins. All of this happened to fulfill the Lord's message through his prophet. Look, the virgin will conceive a child, and he will be called Emmanuel, meaning God with us.
And he's with us
today.
Thank you.
saying and what to pray. God, what your spirit brings through us. I thank you that you're faithful. Thank you that you know and that you see our heart and see our needs. God, you see the future. So God, we will find rest in you today. Find hope in you today. In Jesus' name. Thank you, God. Faithful God. Faithful God. Lord, we just pray for those among us, maybe their physical needs in their body. They need healing in Jesus' name. They need wisdom, provision, open doors. God, they need miracles. They need miracles. God, we stand in the need of you. God, we pray for one another today. God, be exalted. Lord, show yourself mighty in prayer. Nothing is too difficult for you, just like you told Mary. Nothing is too difficult for God. So God, we pray that in faith today. God, we pray for our nation, we pray for our surrounding area, God, as we have been all year. God, pour out your spirit. Visit us, we pray in Jesus' name. Jesus' name, God, we pray that through this season of Emmanuel, over these next couple of weeks, in the name of Jesus, be high and lifted up amidst all the news and amidst even all the stuff of Christmas. Lord, may you be exalted, may lives be changed, captives set free, as they come to know the Messiah as Lord and Savior. God, draw men and women unto yourself, in Jesus' name. And Lord, meet us here today. We come to meet with you today. God, we don't want to be the same when we leave than when we came in. We want to encounter you in your word and your spirit today. Change us and have your way. Our hearts are on your altar today. We'll be obedient to you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Can we see you this morning? Praise his name. Amen. Christmas snow here as we approach Christmas, just 12 days away. Just a couple of reminders. This time of year, our calendar gets all moved around. Brendan Youth Christmas Party Night, we have kids, grades 6 through 12 tonight, here tonight. See Pastor and Emily, and they all need to know 6 o'clock here. And we'll have a great time as they celebrate Christmas and have a little fun. Tonight, we're going to do tonight prayer, a break for the rest of 2020. We'll start 2021, a week of prayer, so we'll be looking for information on that. This is the last week of Bethel Kids Connected, our Monday and Tuesday program. We're going to give them a couple weeks off, the 21st and the 22nd, 28th, and 29th. This Wednesday night is our last midweek for the year. We're going to give them a couple weeks off. There's a running theme here. We're trying to give you a little break right around the Christmas season and hop back in for the new year. This is their Christmas party night this Wednesday night, so be sure to check their leaders before they take a couple weeks off. Next Sunday is our Bible Family Christmas, 6 o'clock. We want you to be here. This is my family, Pastor Ethan Emily's gift to you. We are going to switch it up a little bit this year, more of a soup truck this year. You don't have to bring anything for yourself. So just come. Our family provides kind of a wonderful evening of just being together as we kind of turn the corner into that last Christmas week. And we'll do an open mic time here in the sanctuary if you want to come and share. It's going to be a fun evening for the Bethel family this next week. And dessert bags for everybody. Speaking of treat bags for kids, if they're in children's church, we'll come home with candy today. So just a little heads up on that. They're probably even gone with me so you get in the car. But just a little heads up on that. And then Christmas Eve candlelight services at 4 and 7:30. We're hoping to stream the 7:30 service. We're going to do some testing this week. And then we have our full system set up yet, so what's that going to look like? So that's a possibility. But 4 and 7:30 at Christmas Eve. Christmas hymns and candles and just kind of nice, beautiful time before we turn into the busy days of Christmas. And if you are busy this time of year, David Buck is selling goodies for Speed of Light, apple pies and pumpkin rolls and cookies and some other things. And so if you're interested in that, I know we've got a couple orders in for pumpkin rolls. And all that money will go to mission support our missionaries, so that sign up is out in the lobby. Take out your Bibles, turn to Isaiah chapter 9. I think there's still a few calendars out there. If you need to get all of that, I guess everything kind of shifts a little bit in December. And so I just grabbed one of those on your way out today. Isaiah chapter 9. No kids singing today. We don't have the Bethel Kids Connected choir with us today. And a few things happened this last few days. Everyone's been able to, well, it's not COVID, right? Repeat after me, it wasn't COVID. All right, so they weren't able to sing with us today. So we're gonna miss that. We're kind of looking forward to that. So what page is last Sunday? They're moving to Iowa, Indiana. I know it's Indiana. I don't know why I said Iowa. I guess in my head now. They're moving to Indiana. Bill's already gone. It's a new job. And so we sure to see the girls and Tanya before you go out today. And give them a virtual hug or tap elbows or whatever you do now. So give them a hug and say, we're going to miss these guys being with us. The last couple of years, been a real blessing to our family here. So thank you guys. Our theme this December is Christmas to Remember. All right? That's a little tongue-in-cheek, right? It's a Christmas to Remember. You'll never forget this Christmas. You'll never forget this year, 2020, has been kind of one of those years. Lockdown's a mask and distance learning and all the sorts. And so if you're a person that needs the perfect Christmas, there's snow coming down your window, there's a fire in the fireplace, and everyone's sitting at your feet, and there's all the presents are just what you wanted, and this might be a long month for you, because this is just a little bit of a different year. In fact, our sermon title today is a very 2020 Christmas, and so once again, a little tongue-in-cheek. But adversity is a great opportunity for miracles in the presence of God. God does some of his best work in those times of need. And really, that first Christmas was a beautiful example of God stepping down into a seamless, hopeless situation. And let's read it, Isaiah chapter 9, starting in verse number 1. Nevertheless, there will be no more gloom for those who were in distress. In the past, he humbled the land as they go on the land of Naphtali. But in the future, he will honor Galilee and the Gentiles by the way of the sea along the Jordan. The people walking in darkness have seen a great light. Of those living in the land of the shadow of death, a light has gone. You've enlarged the nation and increased their joy. They rejoice before you, people rejoice at the harvest, as men rejoice when dividing the plunder. For in the day of Midian's defeat, you have shattered the yoke that burdens them. The bar across their shoulders, the rod of their oppressor. Every warrior's boot used in battle, every garment woven in blood will be destined for burning, will be fueled for the fire. For to us a child was born. To us a son is given, and the government will be on his shoulders. He'll be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, and the Prince of Peace. Now the increase of the government and peace there will be no end. The reign of David's throne and over his kingdom, establishing and upholding with justice and righteousness. From that time on and forever, the zeal of the Lord Almighty will accomplish this. Let's pray. God, thank you for this word today. Lord, thank you. You're the God who steps into dark situations. You're the God who sees through the veils. And God sees the future. And so, Lord, our hands and ears today. Lord, have your way in our lives today through this season. And until Jesus comes again, Lord, our hearts are yours. We give you praise. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Now, if you've been around Bethel for a while, my family, we know we love all the traditions and the seasons of the Christmas in December. Our boys were getting married a couple years ago. We typed up an entire page of Christmas, the Mills, Christmas traditions. And we gave it to Emily and said, do every one of these. Or your wonderful crush. Actually, we said, we set you free of all this. So remember, we had that conversation. You don't have any idea. It's just fun things that we've just kind of added into our life. When I bring the tree in every year, we have Russ Pack Christmas CD playing. The same song, same, it's just little simple little things. When Sonny and I were dating, she had this little manger set in her apartment. And so I took the sheep and put it up on top of the stable, because that's what boys do, right? They just, like, their pets. And so ever since then, the sheep goes on top of the stairs. So just little fun things. And we got like a whole page of stuff. And I don't know if you get one, maybe fun stuff like that. You like that too. But guess what? If we lose the Rust Pack CD, it's not the sign of the apocalypse. Jesus is still coming. And Christmas isn't ruined. And I've done everything on my sheet. It's checked off. And it's going to be okay. And let's be honest, this year, 2020, we first come face to face with a lot of challenges this year. Challenges in our lives, our country, our families. A lot of shaking going on. We've talked about that many times this summer. Things have been kind of shaken this year. We've focused on Jesus, the rock that doesn't get shaken. Isaiah 9:1 says, nevertheless, there will be no more gloom for those who are in distress. Nevertheless, there will be no more gloom for those who are in distress. Don't you love that first word of that chapter? Nevertheless. Maybe you get a different version, but my mind reads nevertheless. Everybody's trying to come up with other great words of scripture like but, yet, nonetheless, notwithstanding. The classic Amplified version reads it like this. It just starts with the first three-letter but. But then in parentheses, it says, in the midst of judgment, there is a promise and a certainty of the Lord's deliverance. What's about that? It's just a little thing, but in the Lord's presence. There's a certainty of that of the Lord's deliverance, nevertheless. My personal paraphrase goes like this, that may be true of God. That may all be, so it's a difficult season for Israel. That may all be true, but God, because Isaiah is prophesying, what, about 700 years before Jesus comes, and so it's a long way for the Messiah is coming. And let's be honest, things aren't going very well in Israel and in Judah. Israel, remember, they split up after King Solomon passed away, the nation splits, and the northern 10 tribes, and they've been sacked and carried off by the Assyrians. Judah, the southern 2 tribes, they're on a roller coaster, but about 100 years from now, the Babylonians are going to come and take them away also. Their own sin and rebellion is going to bring the judgment of God. So you've got Isaiah, you've got Hosea, you've got Micah, they're kind of all prophesying and speaking to the nation, kind of during this very similar time in Judah's history. And if you can imagine, everybody's on edge, right? Because the northern 10 tribes just got sacked and carried off by the Assyrians. The Assyrians are the big dog on the block, and they're going to carry them away. And so everybody's just kind of on edge. You know, what's going to happen? What's going to happen to us? If 10 are gone, there's like 2 of us left, and all these things are going through their mind. And effectively, if you've been around Christmas this time of year, you'll hear me, you know, talking about the coming of Jesus in a dark time, right? Because when Jesus comes, there's not been a prophet for 400 years. So the temple's a mess, and the legalism and outward appearances rule the day. And they're back in Jerusalem again, and now Rome has overrun them. And so, all in fact, think of it, leading the 900 years leading up to Jesus' birth weren't the best 900 years. It's been a long few centuries, 900 years of all this is going on. But nevertheless, the people walking in darkness have seen a great light. On those living in the land of the shadow of death, a light has gone. For in the day of meetings, the beat, you shattered the yoke that burdens and the bar across their shoulders, the rod of their oppressor. For to us a child is born. To us a son is given, the government will be on his shoulders, and we call Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Now the increase of his government and peace, there will be no end. And he'll reign on David's throne and over his kingdom, establishing and upholding with justice and righteousness from that time on and forever. The zeal of the Lord Almighty will accomplish this. Nevertheless, something's beginning to stir. Something's beginning to move. In Israel, there's a man named Zechariah, he's a godly man, and he goes in, and it's his turn to go burn incense in the temple that day. And an angel appears to him and says that Elizabeth, even his wife, even though she's very old and has passed her time to really bear children, she's going to give birth to a son, and they'll name him John. And this son will draw Israel back to God and prepare the way of the Lord. We know this John the Baptist. God is beginning to move and to stir. There's Magi, his wise men from the east, and they're studying the stars, and they're looking around, reading the times, and they realize that something is up, and that a king is going to be born of the Jews, and so they're searching to find him, because they want to come worship him, because something's happening. There's a virgin named Mary, and the angel Gabriel appears to her and begins to tell her this fantastic story about, do not be afraid, Mary, you found favor with God. You'll be with child, and give birth to a son, and you're going to give him the name Jesus. He will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High. The Lord God will give him the throne of his father David, and he will reign over the house of Jacob forever. His kingdom will never end. Later he said to her, the Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. And so the Holy One to be born will be called the Son of God. Even Elizabeth, your relative, was going to have a child in her old age. And she who was said to be barren is in her 6th month, for nothing is impossible with God. A young Jewish man, his name's Joseph, and he's pledged to be married to that lady named Mary, but now Mary's pregnant, and he knows it's not his baby, and so he's going to kind of just put her away quietly, not do it the way. Here comes another angel, this one's in a dream, and this angel says, hey, Joseph, son of David, you're not be afraid to take Mary home as your wife, because what is conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit. She'll give birth to a son, and you are to give him the name Jesus, because he will save his people from their sins. All this took place to fulfill what the Lord said to the prophet. The virgin will be with child, and will give birth to a son, and they will call him Emmanuel, which means God with us. It's the prophets. Now, what prophet was that? Who said those words? Well, that was the prophet Isaiah. We just read from Isaiah 9, just a little bit ago, but this is 2 chapters earlier, back in Isaiah 7, where he said, therefore, the Lord himself will give you a sign. The virgin will be with child, will give birth to a son, and they will call him Emmanuel. Nevertheless, God's on the move. All that may be true, but God, notwithstanding, God is on the move. How many of us, sometimes in life, we need a nevertheless. It's in a time in your life like, God, nevertheless, Lord, I trust you, but God, I need you to move COVID and schooling and work and elections and mandates and recommendations and finances and relationships and marriages and loneliness and depression. gloom, distress, people walking in darkness. Our Wednesday night Bible studies, we have a Wednesday night Bible study here in the sanctuary. We've been walking through the 23rd Psalm, and we've had to take November off here, but we're up to verse number 4. Let me read it. We just went through this last Wednesday. Psalm 23:4. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. Now, the valley of the shadow of death is kind of those dark times in our life. It's those shadowy seasons. It's those trails that we can't see very well. It's those striking paths that life takes us on sometimes. You know, back earlier this year, the press kept using the word unprecedented. These are unprecedented times. I don't know if that's quite true, but there's places we've not been before. There's things that we've not traveled this path before. We've never gone that way. We're not sure what to do. We don't really know the way. And what happens to men and women in when they're in those dark places? Sometimes fear can begin to grow. Because I can't see. I'm not sure what's there. I don't know which way to go. I can't see what's out there. I can't see what's ahead of me. Fear and all these things are going on. Where are we? Where are we going? So why does the King David feel fear in the valley of the shadow of death? Well, it says it right there. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. Why? For you are with me. For you are with me. That changes everything. When you're walking with the good shepherd. If you were here on Wednesday night, I shared one of my favorite sermon illustrations. Some of you weren't here, so let me share it for you again today. And so it was about, I don't know, 17, 18 years ago. I think Elizabeth was about 3 or so when the boys were little. And it was right in the middle of winter. You know how in the middle of winter you get sick of winter? Like right now, you're like, some of you are like, let it snow, please let it snow. And by like January or February, you're like, please stop snowing, please stop snowing. So we were in that season of life. We'd take a little 3-day vacation to the Wisconsin Dells, to one of those indoor water parks. A couple of my high school friends brought their families, had a little reunion get together. And so we had a great few days. It was time to go. And really wasn't watching the news or the weather. I knew there was some snow coming. But, you know, everybody else had a lot further to travel than we did. So we didn't think much about it. So we got in the car. It's all interstate. So we're coming home through the middle of Wisconsin. It starts to snow a little bit. It starts to snow a little bit more. And it starts to snow like really hard. And it starts to snow and to blow, and we're on the interstate going about 15 miles an hour because it's just backed up. It's just cars are in the ditch and semis are jackknifed, and it's really getting nasty. It's like an old mini blizzard almost. And so it seems to be getting worse. In fact, it's starting to pile up as the clouds can't get out and barely moving. And so we kind of see a town off in the distance, and Sonny and I start talking, like, we're just going to stop, right? Because this is crazy. And so we took that as it, and there was a some hotel there, so we got some place for the night. And in fact, I found out later that eventually the whole place was shut down, and everything was jackknifed, and they were taking food and going around snowmobiles. So, thank you, Jesus, that we stopped and got a room for the night. And so the kids, you know, the kids think it's great because they're kids. And so, so they're swimming and stuff. And so it comes time for supper, and so the parking lot is almost dripped and shut by now. So, like, well, there's like a Denny's, like a half a block away, you kind of see. And so we kind of all loaded. I mean, the snow by now is just like horizontal, right? It's just coming straight across there. And it's all drifted. It's like, all right, we're going, you know? And so we're all bumped up. We start trudging up. I got Elizabeth. She's like 3. She's holding my hand. And the boys inside are behind me. So we're just kind of, you know, trying to make our way through to the restaurant. And so Sonny and the boys had to stop to help push the car out. So me being a hero, I saved my bugger's life that day. Because I went ahead and I saved my as I walked into the warm restaurant with my wife and kids pushed the car out of the way. And so we went on in, we got a table, so they were put on. So then Sonny and the boys come in, they're like, you know, 4th, 6th grade, whatever. And so they, once again, they just think it's great. And so we're all excited. They're like, oh, Elizabeth, how did you get it? Because you didn't see, because it was really nasty. And she goes, I just closed my eyes and held my daddy's hand. Preach. Right? I just held my eyes and closed my eyes and held my daddy's hand. But sometimes you're walking through the valley and you can't see. And you don't know what's blowing, and you're not sure where you're going, you're not sure what's going to happen. You better hold on to the good shepherd's hand, because guess what? He knows where he's going. Sometimes you're walking through the valley of the shadow of death, and you're not sure which way you've not been this way before. But guess what? You have a heavenly Father. And so sometimes we just need to hold our head's hand and close our eyes and hold on. In fact, what did Jesus say in John 10:10? The thief comes to steal, kill, and destroy. But I have come that they may have life and have it to the full. here's the words of Jesus, I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd lays down his life for the sheep. It's Emmanuel, the God that's with us. He's the good shepherd. He's the God that's with us. That's the one Isaiah is talking about 700 years before. That one day it's going to be dark, but light's going to come. One day it's going to be gloom, but joy is going to begin to stir out of it. He's the great light that's dawning in the darkness. He's the son that's being born that first Christmas. He's the wonderful counselor, the mighty God, the everlasting Father, the Prince of Peace. Nevertheless, God's making a way. After we've been here about like 5 or 6 years, and after you notice that Christmas comes every year, you notice that Christmas keeps coming in every year, so it looked like we may be here a while, so I thought, I better start writing down like my sermon titles and themes for the year, because it's Christmas every year. And so I got this vanilla big red legal sheet out, and I was thinking writing down my sermon titles every year. So, I mean, all of them talk about Christmas, right? But Jesus is not a man, but God is. But at least I was like repeating the same thing every 3 years, you know, by accident. And so I began doing that. So I happened to think about that a couple weeks ago as I was preparing for today, just kind of had scribbled some notes down. And one of those sermons just kind of kept popping back up in my mind. So I pulled my little sheets out, and it was 2007. And as I was going back through my notes, and the title of the sermon was Christmas Interrupted. Christmas Interrupted was the sermon title for that Sunday. Kind of the basic theme was, what happens when all your plans don't go as you planned? What happens then? Or what happens if God interrupts your plan because he's got a better plan? And we talked about Mary and Joseph here. They had plans for life. They're going to get married and start this family. He's a carpenter. All these things are going to be wonderful. And then the angels start showing up. And weird things start happening, and their life is going to take a radical turn. What happens when our plans, you know, I don't know, maybe I like the plan. I've got my list of traditions that we must check off, you know, every Christmas. And so I preached this sermon. Christmas was an amazing sermon. Trust me on that. It was really, really amazing. It was better than today. It was amazing. But then, like a week after that, you know, it's going on, and it's still Christmas season, and then Sonia gets a call, and her cousin, named Sean, has been killed in a motorcycle accident. They're about the same age. She loves God. She's got a family. They're down kind of the Texas-Oklahoma border. And one day after work, he's gone. He's gone. Right in the middle of the Christmas season. So Sonia packs the kids up in the minivan. And I had to stay here. And then they headed off for the funeral. And it was already right on the verge of Christmas Day. And so her family's in Arkansas. And so they just swung on over to Arkansas and spent Christmas with their family. Here I am by myself, and I went down, and I had Christmas with Mom and Dad down in Quincy that year, but I didn't get to check off all the boxes on my to-do list. I had it all planned out. We had the whole month all scheduled out, and then all of a sudden you're in the valley of the shadow of death, and what do you do then? All of a sudden Christmas interrupted and takes a whole new meaning in your life in times like that. Just, you know, my story a few years ago, my dad's failings, it kind of saw his turn for the family to go to Christmas that year. But I just didn't have another year. So I'm like, why don't you guys go down? I'm going to go to Quincy because this could be the, you know, you start thinking those kind of thoughts. And all of a sudden, you know, they could check all the boxes off that year of my little list of all the things that we do. Sometimes you're walking through the valley of the shadow of death. And this wasn't on your plan. It wasn't on your schedule. Christmas gets interrupted, and there's the land of the deep darkness. Nevertheless. But yet, notwithstanding, you know, the first step to a miracle is you gotta have a need. The first step to having a mountain moved in your life is there's gotta be a mountain in your way. Right? Amen. And we'll never learn the goodness of our good shepherd if not some dark paths along the journey of life where you just gotta hold his hand. That's where you learn the value of the good shepherd. That's easy when the pasture's green and the water's flowing. But when you walk through the dark valleys, that's where you learn that the good shepherd really is good. That he really is that Messiah that we talked about. Someone jokingly titled the sermon today, very 2020 Christmas. But the truth is, it's been a very trying year for a lot of people. Fear, isolation, economics, and elections, and divisions, and anger, hopelessness, sickness, relationships. Just the unknown. Now, listen, you could make your own list, and you could add to that list. But nevertheless, the people walking in darkness have seen a great light. Those living in the land of the shadow of death, a light has dawned. You've enlarged the nation and increased their joy. They rejoice before you as people rejoice at the harvest. As men rejoice in the day many is defeated, and dividing the plunder, you shattered the yoke of the burdens, and the bar across their shoulders, the rod of their oppressors. Every warrior's boot moves in battle, every garment rolled in blood will be destined for burning, will be fueled for the fire. For to us a child is born, to us a son is given, and the government will be on his shoulders. He'll be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Of the increase of his government and peace, there will be no end. He'll reign on David's throne and over his kingdom, establishing and upholding it with justice and righteousness from that time on and forever. The zeal of the Lord Almighty will accomplish this. You know, I hope you have a wonderful month, but Christmas isn't about checking all the boxes on your list. It's not about the perfect season of life where everything just flows together. Now, thank God for those times. But it's more about a perfect God who enters a broken, dark, sinful world and brings hope. It's about a God who came and shone light into the darkness when people were lost and broken and afraid. It's a Messiah who lifts our gloom and replaces it with joy. He's the Savior whom they would call the Wonderful Counselor. He's the Mighty God. He's the Everlasting Father. He's the Prince of Peace. He's that Savior who's going to heal the sick and set the oppressed free. He's going to offer life to those who are hopeless in a society that people have been left behind. Jew and Gentile, black, white, Hispanic, slave, free, rich, poor, learned, and unschooled. He wants them all. He wants them all. And he's still in the redemption business today. He's not changed a bit. He's still moving mountains today. He's still turning gloom into joy today. He's still turning darkness to light. He's still turning trouble to peace. Even in 2020, nevertheless, and it may be even more so. I think we need even more of this. We need that God of the nevertheless. You know, Christmas Day, 12 days away, we have a wonderful Christmas Day, peace and joy and family, food, traditions, and Jesus. But maybe today you're in need of, you're going, I need a nevertheless Christmas this year. I need the nevertheless. That's me that he's talking about. Maybe darkness and gloom seem to be the forecast for your Christmas Day. Maybe fear or worry are the theme of your holiday season this year. Maybe 2020 has lived up to its reputation as a year for you this year. This has been a tough place and season that you're in right now. Nevertheless, the light is gone. The gloom can be lifted and joy can come in. Let me tell you about Jesus. Well, that all may be true, oh God, notwithstanding, yet the God of nevertheless. Musicians, some of you guys for today. They're going to come and lead us in some worship just as we kind of close our morning together here today. Like I said, we all have different stories, all different places of life that we are. Right now, this wonderful Savior was coming into the world. In Isaiah 700 years before, even if you read all of Isaiah, there's some dark times in the history. But it comes to chapter 9, he says, nevertheless, let me tell you about the Messiah that's come. That's going to change everything. And he's come. And he's died. And he's rose again. And we can have hope today. Why don't you stand if you're here today? Maybe you're here today, you need a Savior. You need your sins forgiven. Maybe you need a fresh start. You're the prodigal. That's one of today's call to that. Nevertheless, there's hope for you today. Maybe you need surrender. Sometimes we fight with your shepherd, don't we? We don't want to hold him, say, I don't want to hold your hand. But go, I'm going to do my own thing. Like, I'm going to make my own path. Sometimes we just need surrender. Maybe God just wanted to wrap his arms of grace around him today and say, I got you. Thank God when he moves the mountains. Thanks God when he walks us through the valleys. And he said, hey, hold my hand. Okay. You're going to lead us to worship here today. You just want to pray with you. You just want to come and kneel and hang out with Jesus for a while. I'd love to do that. I'd love to pray with you today. Maybe you just want to spend some time. Let's worship him. Let's draw close to him. Nevertheless, God is faithful. Nothing's impossible. Leave us to this.